Well, good evening, everyone. We'll try that again. Good evening, everyone. We're so glad that you're here. We're so glad that you took my advice, said if you don't come to Maundy Thursday service, you can't come to Easter. Right? Right? There we go. This service, how many of you have been to Maundy Thursday before? How many of this is your first time? Okay, so bears a little explanation. This is a decidedly non-West Press service, but it's become a definitionally West Press service, if you get my meaning on it. So I'm going to kind of walk you through the service so you know approximately what we're about and how we're doing things. So if you'd open to the front of your bulletin there, like past the cover there, you will notice a couple of different things. First of all, the word Monday comes from the Latin word mandate. Actually, Monday is mandate for the English word mandate, which Jesus says in John 13:14. So if I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. It is a service. If you guys could start sliding over a little bit to make room for the Maldonados who are late, that would be great. I didn't pick on Elsie, but Jacob, but I will. That's right. This service consists of three elements of three different parts. So it begins with communion. We move into tenebrae, and I'll explain that in just a second. And then there's recessional. The communion is just the normal thing that we've all done. If you've never taken communion with us before, we have an open table at West Press. Everyone who wants to take communion can take communion. That's the way that it works here. Some of us have been raised in the Roman Catholic tradition, and it's not allowed in the Presbyterian Church. It is. We will do it the way we typically do it, where we'll eat the bread first, then hold the cup that we can take that together. And then what we're going to do is we're going to move into the service of tenebrae. Tenebrae is basically a Latin word meaning shadows. And at this part, what we're going to do is we're going to do readings to walk us to the cross. And as each reading goes through, the sanctuary will be progressively darkened through that process until eventually we are completely in darkness. What will happen then is that a bell will begin to toll, and from the front of the church going towards the back of the church, we will exit the sanctuary. I think of this part a little like the whole idea of a Christmas carol. Bear with me for a second. In the story, Dickens' story of a Christmas carol, Scrooge gets an opportunity to change his life. And what we've done tonight is we have confronted you with the issue that the means of grace are going to be removed from you. When Jesus died on the cross, it was for all of us. But the grace that we have was ushered into our lives. But what we're going to do tonight is we're going to take that grace away from you. So as we, first of all, look around, you'll notice that most of the color has been removed from the sanctuary. The banners are not up. Our paraments are not up. The candles in the back, the color is not here. We also have taken away from you your prayer concern cards. You can't do a prayer concern tonight. And that's a means of grace for us. We've taken away the information card so you can get on our email list. You may go, well, that's a good thing. But stop and think about it. You can't begin to participate in the community that way. We've taken away from you your offering envelopes. And you go, excellent, I don't have to give. No, you do. But we're not making it easier for you to give tonight. It's becoming more and more difficult. So that's what's already been taken away from you. What else has been taken away from you? Can you see it right in front of you? No Bibles. Your Bibles have been taken away from you. Again, means of grace, ways of God demonstrating to us his love, communicating that love for us. At the conclusion of the service, when it's very dark, the leaders in the service are going to remove the elements that are up here, further removing the grace from you. We will walk out the doors of the sanctuary, again from the front, moving our way back. When we all get out onto the grass, we're going to sing the song that's in your bulletin, Were You There When They Crucified My Lord? And then what's going to happen is, I'm going to walk through all of you, through the group, and I'm going to slam the doors of the sanctuary shut. So when you leave the sanctuary, take all your things with you, especially your small children. Don't leave them here, please. the sanctuary will remain closed. Now, tomorrow, it'll be open from noon to 3 for prayer, but it will still be shrouded. When you walk in on Easter Sunday, then, when all the darkness and all the brokenness and all the grace taken away from us, there is a visceral feeling of, thank God, I get to celebrate this holy day with my family and my friends. So we're going to go into the service, but before we do that, I want to ask you to please silence your cell phones. And then secondly, let's greet each other, because we're not going to be able to do that. When you leave this place tonight, I want you to leave so silently. Until you get in your car, please don't say a word. I just want you to live with that moment. So let's stand and welcome each other to worship this evening.
Your response can be found in the bulletin. Hear now this call to worship. Behold, what manner of love the Father has given unto us, that we should be called the children of God, and so we are. Greater love has no man than this, that he gave his life for his friends.
In the morning, I rise. In the morning, when I rise. In the morning, when I rise, give me Jesus. Give me Jesus. Give me Jesus, you can have all this world, but give me Jesus. And when I am alone, and when I am alone, oh, when I am alone, give me Jesus. Give me Jesus. Give me Jesus. You can have all this. And when I come to die, Lord, when I come to die, and when I come to die, give me Jesus. Give me Jesus.
Give me Jesus, you can have all this world. You can have all this world. You can have all this world, but give me Jesus. You may be seated.
Let's bow our heads in prayer. We do not presume to come to your table, O merciful God, trusting in our own goodness, but in your all-embracing love and mercy. We are not worthy even to gather the crumbs under your table, but it is always your nature to show mercy. So we gather. Grant, therefore, as we worship you, as we eat the bread and drink the cup, and as we experience your last hours, we may remain in you and you in us. For the joy set before Christ, for the hope of Easter morning, and for the power of the resurrection. Amen.
Friends, this is a joyful feast of the people of God. Men and women will come from east and from west, from north and from south, and to sit at this table. This is the Lord's table. And our Lord invites all of those who trust in him to share this feast which he has prepared. Let us pray. O holy God, Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, with joy we give you thanks and praise. We need not hide ourselves from you, before whose justice none can stand. Your mercy was proclaimed by the apostles and the prophets and shown forth to us in Jesus Christ. You gave your law to guide us, and you promised new life for all, that we may live to serve you among all of our neighbors in all that we do and all that we say. You sent your Son, Jesus Christ, who died and rose again to save us. By his death on the cross, you revealed that the love of your heart has no limit. By raising him from the grave, you comfort us with the blessed hope of eternal life. By his victory, you assure us that neither death, nor life, nor things present, nor things to come can separate us from your love in Jesus Christ our Lord. How marvelous are your ways, O God! How marvelous is your name, O Holy One. You alone are God. Therefore, with apostles and prophets and that great cloud of witnesses who live for you beyond all time and space, we lift our hearts in joyful praise. We praise you, most holy God, for sending your only Son, Jesus Christ, to live among us. Full of grace and truth, he made you known to all who received him, sharing our joy and sharing our sorrow. He healed the sick and was a friend of sinners. Obeying you, he took up his cross and died that we might live. We praise you that he overcame death and that he is risen to rule the world and that he is still the friend of sinners. We trust him to overcome every power that can hurt or divide us, and we believe that when he comes in glory, we will celebrate victory with him. We thank you that on the night before our Lord and Savior died, he took bread and gave thanks and broke it, saying, "This is my body given for you. Do this for remembrance of me." In the same way, he also took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant sealed in my blood, shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, in remembrance of your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we take this bread and this cup and give you the praise and the thanksgiving. Let us proclaim the mystery of faith. Please repeat after me. Christ has died.
Christ is risen.
Christ will come again.
Will come again.
Gracious God, pour out your Holy Spirit upon us. that this bread and this cup may be for us the body and blood of our Lord, and that we and all who share in this feast may be one with Christ and he with us. Fill us with your Spirit. Provide eternal life for us, that with joy we may be your faithful people until we feast with you in glory. Through Christ, with Christ, in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor are yours, Almighty Father, forever and ever. Amen. I'd like to invite our communion servers to come forward if they would please. And once again, I'd like to remind you that to eat of the bread as soon as we are served, but hold the cup that we could take that together. Come to the table of the Lord. Thank you.
drink it deeply. Tonight's offering is one of several that we take throughout the year to help us maintain this building that has been entrusted to us. I'd like to invite our ushers to come forward. Let us pray. God, this night, as we contemplate your ultimate sacrifice on the cross, we pray to be reminded that not only did you die so that we might live, but that you have given us so many gifts to nurture our lives. The world around us, our family and friends, and this church within which we worship and serve. Give us wisdom in caring for this important resource. In your name we pray. Amen. Good Caiaphas, the council waits for you. The Pharisees and priests are here for you. Ah, gentlemen, you know why we are here. We've not much time and quite a problem here.
In town right now to whip up some support.
A rabble-rousing mission that I think we must abort.
He is dangerous.
Superstar.
He is dangerous.
Lord Caiaphas, they're right outside our yard.
Quick, Caiaphas, go call the Roman guard.
No, wait. We need a more permanent solution to our problem.
What can you do about the Nazareth hero and miracle wonder of fools?
No riot, no war, no fight,
no slogan. One thing I'll say for him, Jesus is cool.
We cannot leave him to his own devices.
His half-witted fans will get out of control.
But how can we stop him?
His glamour increases.
By leaks every minute.
He's the top of the whole school.
I see bad things are rising. The crowd running clean, which the Romans would ban. I see blood and destruction. Our elimination because of one man. Blood and destruction. Because of one man.
Because of one man.
Elimination. Because of one man.
Because of one. Because of one. Because of one man.
What then to do about this Jesus mania?
How do we handle the carpenter king? Where do we start with the man who
is bigger? And John was when John grabbed his
thing. Fools you! Have no perception. The stakes we are gambling are frightening high. We must crush him completely. So like John before him, this Jesus must die. For the sake of the nation, this Jesus must die.
Must die, this Jesus must die.
So like John before him, this Jesus must die.
Must die, this Jesus must die.
Please look in your bulletins for the Litany of the Cross. Lord, when we pity ourselves and think we make great sacrifices,
Lord, when our patience wears thin and we are ready to give up,
us, Fuvius.
Lord, when we get angry and wish to retaliate against our enemies, Lord, when we feel rejected or persecuted for doing what is right and good, Lord, when we suffer of body or anguish of mind in this life, Lord, when we are afraid to stand for what is true and honorable, Lord, when we feel alone in the world, forsaken, forgotten, Lord, when we come to the time of our own death, Lord, when we are tempted by despair or fear of what lies ahead,
the shadow of betrayal on the first day of the Feast of Unleavened Bread. The disciples came to Jesus and asked,
"Where do you want us to make preparations for you to eat the Passover?"
He replied,
"Go into the city to a certain man and tell him, 'The teacher says, my appointed time is near. I'm going to celebrate the Passover with my disciples at your house.'"
So the disciples did as Jesus had directed them and prepared the Passover. When evening came, Jesus was reclining at the table with the 12. And while they were eating, he said,
"I tell you the truth, one of you will betray me."
They were very sad and began to say to him one after the other,
"Surely not I, Lord."
Jesus replied,
"The one who has dipped his hand into the bowl with me will betray me. The Son of Man will go just as it is written about him, but woe to that man who betrays the Son of Man. It would be better for him if he had not been born."
Then Judas, the one who would betray him, said,
"Surely not I, Rabbi."
Jesus answered,
"Yes, it is you."
The shadow of an unshared vigil. Jesus went out as usual to the Mount of Olives, and his disciples followed him. On reaching the place, he said to them,
"Pray that you will not fall into temptation."
He withdrew about a stone's throw beyond them, knelt down, and prayed,
"Father, if you are willing, take this cup from me. Yet not my will, but yours be done."
An angel of the Lord appeared to him and strengthened him. And being in anguish, he prayed more earnestly, and his sweat was like drops of blood falling to the ground. When he arose from prayer and went back to the disciples, he found them asleep, exhausted from sorrow.
"Why are you sleeping? Get up and pray so that you will not fall into temptation."
The shadow of desertion. While he was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived. With him was a large crowd, armed with swords and clubs, sent from the chief priests and the elders of the people. Now the betrayer had arranged a signal with them.
"The one I kiss is the man. Arrest him."
Going at once to Jesus,
Judas kissed him and said,
"Greetings, Rabbi."
Jesus replied,
"Friend, do what you came for."
Then the men stepped forward, seized Jesus, and arrested. With that, one of Jesus' companions reached for his sword, drew it out, and struck the servant of the high priest, cutting off his ear. Jesus said to him,
"Put your sword back in its place, for all who draw the sword will die by the sword."
"Do you think I cannot call on my Father and he will at once put at my disposal more than 12 legions of angels?"
"But how then would the scriptures be fulfilled that say it must happen in this way?"
At that time, Jesus said to the crowd,
"Am I leading a rebellion that you have come out with swords and clubs to capture me?"
"Every day I sat in the temple courts teaching, and you did not arrest me."
"But this has all taken place that the writings of the prophets might be fulfilled."
Then all the disciples deserted him and fled.
The shadow of accusation. Those who had arrested Jesus took him to Caiaphas, the high priest, where the teachers of the law and the elders had assembled. But Peter followed at a distance, right up to the courtyard of the high priest. He entered and sat down with the guards to see the outcome. The chief priests and the whole Sanhedrin were looking for false evidence against Jesus so they could put him to death. But they did not find any, though many false witnesses came forward. Finally, two came forward and declared,
"This fellow said, 'I am able to destroy the temple of God and rebuild it in 3 days.'"
Then the high priest stood up and said to Jesus,
"Are you not going to answer? What is this testimony that these men are bringing against you?"
But Jesus remained silent. The high priest said to him,
"I charge you under oath by the living God. Tell us if you were the Christ, the Son of God."
"Yes, it is as you say. But I say to all of you, in the future you will see the Son of Man sitting at the right hand of the Mighty One and coming on the clouds of heaven."
Then the high priest tore his clothes and said,
"He has spoken blasphemy! Why do we need any more witnesses? Look, now you've heard the blasphemy. What do you think?
He is worthy of death.
The shadow of crucifixion. Then the governor's soldiers took Jesus into the praetorium and gathered the whole company of soldiers around him. They stripped him and put a scarlet robe on him, and then twisted together a crown of thorns and set it on his head. They put a staff in his right hand and knelt in front of him and mocked him.
"Hail, King of the Jews!"
They spit on him and took the staff and struck him on the head again and again. After they had mocked him, they took the robe off and put his own clothes on him. Then they led him away to crucify him.
Shadow of death. From the sixth hour until the ninth hour, darkness came over all the land. About the ninth hour, Jesus cried out in a loud voice,
"Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani? My God, why have you forsaken me?"
When some of those who were standing there heard this, they said,
"He's calling Elijah."
Immediately, one of them ran and got a sponge. He filled it with wine vinegar and put it on a stick and offered it to Jesus to drink. The rest said,
"Now leave him alone. Let's see if Elijah comes to save him."
And when Jesus cried out again in a loud voice, he gave up his spirit. At that moment, the curtain in the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. The earth shook, the rocks split, the tombs broke open, and the bodies of many holy people who had died were raised to life. They came out of the tombs, and after Jesus' resurrection, they went into the holy city and appeared to many people. When the centurion and all who were with him, who were guarding Jesus, saw the earthquake and all that had happened, they were terrified and exclaimed,
"Surely he was the Son of God."
Shadow of the tomb. Many women were there watching from a distance. They had followed Jesus from the Galilee to care for his needs. Among them were Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James and Joseph, and the mother of Zebedee's sons. As evening approached, there came a rich man from Arimathea named Joseph, who had himself become a disciple of Jesus. Going to Pilate, he asked for Jesus' body, and Pilate ordered that it be given to him. Joseph took the body, wrapped it in clean linen cloths, and placed it in his own new tomb that he had cut out of the rock. He rolled a big stone in front of the entrance to the tomb and went away.